Okay, we're in the test cell on a dark and snowy night just before Halloween. What better time than right now to try to answer your questions 43. Let's get in out of the echo to the control room where I will try to do that. Okay, we're in the control room here with the ongoing work with the AI 25 turbofan. And here's our checklist of things. This is Byron's checklist of things to do. This is our checklist of channels we need to monitor. And we've got one missing so far, oil pressure. Once we get oil pressure, you can fire it up. Okay. And this, if you're interested, is a schematic diagram of the fuel system. This is a different, a nicer, picturesque kind of diagram of the fuel system. This is very schematic. This is more accurate, but also schematic, more detailed. This lists all the things, and there you go. That's what we've got to get working. First question. Question number one by Neil Elliott. Jet fuel, what the heck is it? Does octane matter? Octane does not matter because the fuel is not compressed in a contained volume where it will heat up and possibly ignite with the air. The fuel is not mixed with the air before it actually needs to burn. So it doesn't matter what it is. It can be liquefied wax, it can be butter, it can be alcohol, it can be kerosene, gasoline, a mixture of all those things, lighter fluid. Who cares? Because right where the fuel nozzle puts the fuel into the air, that's where it can burn. And so even if the compressed air is at very high temperatures, enough to ignite fuel, that's fine. There's no such thing as pre-ignition, because as soon as the fuel gets into the air, it ignites. And so the actual anti-knock or anti-detonation or fuel burning characteristics are not that important. If you were to superheat asphalt liquid, the black tar in roads, that would work, but it would leave a lot of residue and gunk and soot and muck behind. But it would make adequate power until things clogged up. So typically you want a liquid that will flow at very cold temperatures and won't leave deposits or break down and coke up inside the fuel nozzles, which can get fairly hot, but they are cooled by the massive amounts of fuel going through them. You also want something that's not going to destroy rubber seals. You want something that's going to help the fuel pumps live a bit longer. That's why jet fuel and diesel are a bit more lubricitous. They're more like a lubricant than, say, gasoline. Engines have a shorter life running on gasoline only because that's harder on the mechanical components of the fuel system, not so much on the fuel nozzles, combustors, and turbines. Good question by Neil Elliott. Okay, one of the advantages to us being in a test cell is there's always buckets of jet fuel laying around that leaks out of lines. It doesn't leak out of the lines when they're connected, it leaks when you break the connection and you're changing the fuel system around. So we've got that right here. Let's just try not to do too much quick motion here. This is the 2-inch line that comes from the outside into the filtered fuel inlet of the engine. So it connects right here. That is the same kind of line, but it handles air for the starter. So we have to know what we're doing here. It goes right underneath the fuel line. That is the connection for the fuel line. So we've broken the fuel line connection so we can get the crane through. And this is what comes out when you break the connection. And it appears that the flies that live in the test cell like to land on jet fuel. This is not giving off any vapors, and if I dropped a match into it, it probably wouldn't light. I know that's hard to believe, but jet fuel is much, much, much safer than gasoline. We actually have a burning barrel outside that we burn garbage in once in a while because we are on the ragged edge of civilization. Sometimes we do that. The other day, I soaked an old pair of denim jeans that I threw away, soaked them with jet fuel, and went down with a Bic lighter, and I could not light them.
I could not light them on fire. So I took a propane torch and I stuck it right on the wet denim. Jet fuel, wet denim, and I couldn't light it. So I did it again for about 5 seconds. Nothing. So then I held the propane torch directly on the wet denim, soaked with jet fuel, for about 15 seconds and finally got a tiny little flame. And then yes, it does burn with great energy, but if that was gasoline, it would have blown up in my face. Jet fuel is much, much safer than gasoline. If you drop a lit match into a pool of jet fuel, it might burn, it might not. But with gasoline, it's gonna explode. Anyway, that is jet fuel, and that's what we'll be running in there in just a few days, hopefully.
Okay, question number two is by LeVar Taylor. What's the newest engine you've worked with? The newest engine I've worked with would have to be the LM500. It was designed in the 70s. It's still in operation now with the A-10 with the US Air Force and with the Canadair Regional Jet. And there are other small airliners that use the CF-34. Also the S-3 Viking, the anti-submarine Navy dual engine aircraft that works on aircraft carriers. Yeah, good question. The newest engine I've worked with, that would be the CF-34/LM500. That is definitely the newest. All the other ones are either still in operation because they're highly successful, or they are used by collectors of classic jets because they came in a really cool aircraft that people like and people can afford, and they are engines from the 50s. So, yeah, LM500, CF-34. I have not dealt with all the newer, complicated aviation stuff like the P and the Pratt & Whitney F100 and the Rolls-Royce Pegasus. That's kind of an old one also. Nothing fabulously new, sorry, but sometimes, as you car guys know, the older stuff is cooler. And actually, if you watch the startup of a GE J47, designed in like 1947-ish, starts with fire and flames and smoke and drama, and it's fantastic, it's a monster. And if you look at the LM2500, which was designed in the late 60s, it's an extremely efficient and civilized machine. It just does what it does with no drama, no smoke, no fire. It makes a lot more power, but what do you find more exciting? I don't know, I kind of like the older jets. There you go, to each his own. Good question by LeVar Taylor. Okay, we're out here in front of the AI-25 turbofan, yet to have its bell mouth installed. It's gonna be quite cool, I'll try to film that. Because the power that we're basking under the light from is supplied by our Generac generator unit. And the third question is by JPAT1000. And he wants to know whether we know which plant the Generac unit came from. If it's from the Oshkosh plant, he may have tested it. He likes the smell of jet exhaust. And what does one smell like running on propane? I would imagine you'd smell almost nothing. I don't know which plant the Generac unit came from. Sorry. Running on propane, the engine, when it's making a lot of power, smells like almost like a barbecue. A little bit of fuel smell, or like a propane-powered taxi, if you've smelt that. Not bad. But at low RPMs, there's not as much air mixing with the fuel, and the combustion is somewhat inefficient. And so the smell of propane has got an acidy, sweet tang to it, and it really stings your eyes. And if you watch some of my videos on the Olympus, the recent one on the Olympus, I'm standing back there, right over there, outside, and I'm at the edge of the exhaust stream when it's idling, and it's kind of buffeting me. And when it does, I get a stinging hot wind in my eyes. It's like having vinegar dropped in your eyes. Thankfully, it goes away when you get out of the exhaust, but it's got a sharp smell to it, and I don't know what that is. Maybe that's the nitrous oxides, but the oxides of nitrogen, NOx they're called, they are also called air pollution. So they're nasty on the eyes. Good question by JPAT1000. Okay, fourth question by Keith M. Thanks for your videos. I have a two-part question. You may have gone over this before, and I apologize if I missed it. In a modern turbofan engine, is any thrust produced by the core, or is it like your examples of a turboshaft engine where the thrust from the core is converted to power for the fan and reduced to almost zero? It depends. You can pretty much guess the ratio of thrust produced, is that right? Vaguely, by the bypass ratio. The old JT8Ds in the 707, no, the 707 didn't have JT8Ds, but the 727 and the 737, the early ones with the long tube-shaped engines, those are JT8Ds. That's a one-to-one bypass ratio engine. So that means half of the air coming in the front of the engine goes through the core and half goes through the bypass duct. And about one-to-one ratio of thrust from the jet exhaust and the bypass exhaust, about. But the fan is better at making thrust, and so as the bypass ratio goes up, the thrust goes up even more, sort of. Okay, so for example, in I think it's the TF34, like the LM500, the TF34 has a 5.5 to 6 to 1 bypass ratio. So a little bit more than 5 times the air goes around the core than goes through the core. So you've got about 15 to 20% of the thrust of the engine is produced by the core exhaust. With an aviation engine, it's okay to let the core make some of the thrust, and that might save you another stage on the LP turbine, which saves complexity, weight, and expense. And so you sort of trade off how much thrust comes out the jet nozzle and how much comes by the fan based on economics and other compromise decisions. With an industrial power unit, the weight of the unit doesn't matter, the cost does matter, but you don't want to have any thrust or power coming out of the core, because that's going to be essentially wasted, because that is it's power that's not captured by the power turbine. So oftentimes when an engine is converted from an airliner engine to a power ground power unit, like the CF6 was to the LM2500, the manufacturer, GE, added another stage to the LPT to extract even more power from the exhaust stream and have basically nothing left over for jet exhaust. Yeah, that's a good question. Okay, part two of his question is, in a Super Cruise aircraft with a turbofan such as the F-22, how is air moved at a supersonic speed by the fan? I don't know. I think what happens is the aircraft inlet is designed so that even at supersonic speeds, the air is decelerated so that it enters the compressor of the engine at subsonic speeds. That's what happens. Exactly how it does that, I do not know. There's a supersonic diffuser followed by a subsonic diffuser, and they are opposite. And this is one of the problems that comes up all the time in people's misunderstanding about these engines, is that supersonic airflow is to be avoided inside the engine because everything goes backwards and haywire. Everything's different. And most people's intuitive understanding of airflow is only appropriate for supersonic airflow. I don't know why. I think it's because you're watching, it's raining outside, and all the rain is coming down in a curtain off the eaves troughs of your plugged up drain system on your house. And you can stick shapes into that falling water, and the falling water behaves in certain ways. And if you do this, the water compresses into a stream. And that's what people seem to think air does on supersonic. Supersonic airflow is kind of like that, but it's the exact opposite subsonically. So anyway, my only suggestion is to read some books about aerodynamics and Bernoulli equations and the relationships of the flowing of air and the shape of objects around it and what it goes through. Okay, is there a system that redirects the fan thrust into the core at Super Cruise? No. You don't put fan thrust into the core ever. I think this is a confusion of the system used in the J58 for the SR-71, where the compressor is bypassed and inlet air, which is compressed simply by deceleration from supersonic to subsonic speeds, is passed directly into the combustor around the compressor. It's a very unique engine. No other engine does that, and that's all I know about it. In the diagrams I've seen, I cannot seem to locate the bypass section, making me think this is a very fancy turbojet, though it is referred to as a turbofan. Okay, let's do a quick diagram. Let's draw a bypass turbofan. First, we'll make the turbojet. You guys have done this with me so many times, you must be sick of it. Okay, there is the air coming in. There's the air coming out really fast. Nice arrow. Let's make the compressor. It's a generic compressor, shaft, turbine. Yeah, the combustors, it's all the same color. Now, how do we make it a turbofan? We put another turbine here, another one, and we pass the shaft of this turbine through this shaft. I know it's a diagram, just use your imagination. And you put a fan there. Make it a one-stage fan. There's the turbofan, and there's the inlet duct. And in an aircraft, you would have it basically do that. In a fighter jet. So now let's use some different colors. I'm gonna change the air to green. So inlet air here. And if it's bypass air, it goes through here, comes out there, like that. And if it's core air, let's make it hot, core air comes out here. And it's going faster. And so you've got a lot of it coming in here, in there too. There, does that make any sense? This thing, let's make it black for fun. Let's make this thing. It's sheet metal. It's this thing here. And this is the outer case of the core of the engine. It would be the outer case of the engine if it was a turbojet. That thing, that empty space, is the bypass duct. And it's called a bypass duct because it's a duct, although from the front the engine looks like that. It's this part. Right in there, there's the core of the engine. Let's make the engine, there it is. It's that. And there's struts, you know, making sure it doesn't fly away like a pop can. It's a tube. It's an annular tube, it's a duct where the bypass air goes. And it's called bypass air because it bypasses the core. So it's a bypass duct. Very interesting original name, don't you think? It's a tube that carries air around the engine. The air bypasses the engine through a tube or a duct, the bypass duct. Easy. Easy to draw, easy to see. Okay. Good one. So anyway, Keith, a turbofan is a fancy turbojet. It's a turbojet that has had extra features added to it. Now, obviously, when you're going to make a new engine, you're not going to keep the turbojet core exactly the same. Because knowledge and ability increases with time, and even if it's 1 year after you introduce your new turbojet, you can make improvements, and it becomes a point where do you want to make improvements to the old engine, or do you want to make a whole new engine because there are so many improvements that the parts would interchange and the thing would not be recognizable. It's kind of like what happened with the J79 and the 1500. They designed the LM2500, but they didn't just stick a fan onto a J79. They thought, how can we improve the J79? And there were so many ways to improve it, as well as adding a low pressure stage and a fan, that it was essentially an unrecognizable engine from the J79. They share no parts whatsoever, except for bolts. But that's basically what they did. They took an engine about the size of a J79, made it better in every way, and made it a turbofan. So it's a whole new engine, but it's in spirit It's a J79 with an LP stage and a fan. There you go. Really good question, hard to answer, kind of fun, for Keith M. Thanks for that one. Okay, and last question by Chris Wasson. Chris Wasson. It's actually two questions, and so I'm going to answer them quickly. Great videos, thanks for making them. I've heard that B-52s inject water into their engines to get them airborne. Is water injection ever used in industrial settings to increase power output? Actually, that's good. This is a good question because I don't have to explain how the B-52 water injection system works. Good. Yes, water injection is used in industrial settings to either do one of two things. You can increase mass airflow and decrease firing temperature, so you can ram more fuel in there and make even more power, or you can just use it to decrease firing temperature and it lowers NOx emissions. And a lot of industrial power plants are limited by the amount of NOx they're allowed to put into the air. So water injection is used for that, and the most common type of water is deionized or distilled water. And I guess if you were really smart, you could distill the water with the waste heat from the exhaust of the engine and have it just ready for injection. That would be really cool. I don't know if anybody does that, but if they do, I'm impressed. Okay. Second part of this question. Have we had any dealings with engines affected by volcanic ash, and can you explain what the big problem with it is? No and yes. We've never seen one. We have had engines with metal debris on the turbine blades, melted metal debris. And that's what the problem with volcanic ash is. It's very fine, and so it doesn't get centrifuged out in the compressor. It flows with the air into the combustor. The small portion of the volcanic ash, most of it blows right through, and it acts like a very fine abrasive, which is damaging to everything. But the 20% or so of the air that gets used for actual burning of the fuel, the ash is going to be there in the flame. And the flame is several thousand degrees, hot enough to melt rock. And then you have tiny little specks of melted rock in your air flying backwards towards your nozzles. And it gets deposited as the air cools. The whole point of the combustor and the combustor liner is to use cooling air to cool that air to a temperature of about 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit so the turbine blades can handle it. Well, the turbine blades don't melt at 1,000 Fahrenheit, and neither does rock. The rock congeals out, or what's the word? Fuses. The rock fuses. It hardens. It's like ice. It freezes. Okay, it freezes. It fuses or freezes out of the air into either hard particles and hits the turbines, which damages it, or because there's a bit of, let's call it thermal inertia. The air cools down instantly when it mixes, and the rock particles, however small they are, might take a few inches of travel, or a few thousandths of a second, to coalesce. And in that time, they're still molten and they stick to the turbine blades, or the nozzles. On the turbine blades, that's going to destroy their aerodynamic efficiency by changing their shape, and it's going to wreck the balance because they're heavy. But most of all, let's turn the camera to the diagram thing again. If you look at the surface of a nozzle guide vane or a turbine nozzle, I'll see if I can go get one. You have, let's do a cross section of it. There's a cross section of a turbine nozzle guide vane. They'll have tiny little holes along the leading edge and sometimes along the trailing edge where the air gets pumped inside and comes out these little holes to cool the surface and allow it to protect it from damage from the hot gases. And these are engines that run with a very hot firing temperature, hot enough so that if the blades weren't cooled, they'd melt. So they're air cooled. Well, the rock melts at a higher temperature than the metal, and so it fuses out of this liquid state to the solid state at a high enough temperature to still melt the metal. It sticks there and it plugs those holes and it just melts the thing, and you've wrecked your engine and you're going out of the sky. Okay, let's see. We're going to try to film some film cooling holes. What are we going to do? These are nozzles out of an engine. I'm not sure what this is from.
This is out of an LM2500. So, let's get some light. Can you see the trailing edge? There's holes right there that are easy to see. Yeah. And the very trailing edge. I'm going to try to zoom that in. Does that work? Move it out of the way. Yes. Those are tiny holes. Those are like half a millimeter in diameter. And they're long. Long holes deep into the metal. There's an air chamber. You can see the holes at the top there allow the air to exit. Let's see a bit better contrast. And there's holes on the leading edge. And on what is commonly called the suction face. This is the pressure face and the suction face, or the concavity and the convexity. Whatever you want to call it. So those holes would be deposited with basically molten rock, like a glassy type material. And when they're plugged, these have a lot of air rushing through them, even though they're very small. If you plug those, you get a hot spot, and eventually you get melting, burning, and destruction. This is on a turbine blade, a moving part of the engine, and this is from another engine, but it's what diverts that air into the turbine blade. Trailing edge is very thin, as you can see, and if it was to get hot, too hot, it would burn, melt through. The air for cooling goes through there, it enters there, and it looks like it enters from both ends, or it passes through a portion of the air. A portion of the air leaves these vanes through their trailing edge, and a portion of it continues on to do other things. Very cool. Anyway, those are the cooling air holes that will get plugged and destroy your engine if there's too much volcanic ash being ingested by the compressor.
So, yeah, good question, Chris. Very interesting. We have not dealt with an engine dealing with, I was going to say hydraulic, but I meant to say volcanic ash. From the test cell, late at night with the snow falling outside, thanks for watching.